Hi, everybody. My name is Michael Uhrich. I'm the founder and chief economist with Seventh Point Analytic Consulting. Appreciate everybody joining today to discuss how to estimate new product incrementality and cannibalization, because they're kind of sort of each the flip side of the other, right? So without much ado, a little bit of ado here up front, just real quick, what's Seventh Point Analytic Consulting? It's a full service analytic and strategic consultancy. So we help folks in consumer products. We specialize in beverage alcohol. If you are facing a big decision, you're not sure which way to go and you want some analytics to support that decision, make sure you're making the right one, we can help. If you want to assess the outcome of a decision you've already made or an event that took place in the market, something that happened to you in your business, we can help assess that. If you want to understand the market better in general, or if you're not looking to make a decision on your own, but you want to help motivate a partner of yours to make a particular decision, we can help with that as well. That applies to suppliers you're working with. It applies to distributor and retailer partners. If you're trying to get your assortment expanded, if you're trying to affect pricing in the marketplace, if you're trying to achieve really any goal with your business, there's no reason not to apply some analytical rigor to supporting that decision or to helping to motivate your partners to make a different decision than they otherwise might too. And we can help. All right, today we're going to talk about new product incrementality. What's new product incrementality? So you have a portfolio of products that you're selling right now, and they're selling how much they're selling. You launch a new product, and your new product is going to be now a part of your overall portfolio sales. But it's not necessarily the case that after you launch the new product, you're going to still keep selling the same amount of the other products that you were already selling in the past. You're going to keep selling some volume. Those existing products are going to have on top of them some organic growth, and that could actually be negative. Organic changes to your portfolio's volume could happen for any number of reasons that are not related to the launch of your new product. But then the new product itself is going to have some volume that it would have sold just by itself, and it may have some volume that it's cannibalizing from your existing products. So after you've launched the new product, your products that you already had before are going to include some base sales, some organic growth, which again could be negative. And your new product sales are going to have an incremental portion and a cannibalized portion. And what we're looking to do here today is estimate how much of the new product sales are incremental. And that will also tell us how much are cannibalized. All right. Now, why does it matter? So as I mentioned before, new products often cannibalize existing ones. And if that happens, if they cannibalize enough of your existing products, then you're going to lose profitability off those products. If they either cannibalize enough volume or if they are a lot less profitable than the products that they're cannibalizing, or both. Both situations can be bad. Generally, you're going to know if the new product that you're launching is a lot less profitable. So say the new product that you're launching is the same brand of beer, but it's in a package that is a lot more expensive to make. That's going to be a less profitable new product. Now, it can still be incremental, both in terms of volume, revenue, margin, if you sell enough of it that is incremental. If it's 100% incremental, meaning it does not influence your existing products at all, then even if it's less profitable, you're still gaining more profits, albeit fewer, less margin per unit. But if it cannibalizes a lot and it's less profitable, you're going to end up making less money. So how is incrementality typically estimated? The most common approach that I've seen used in the marketplace is folks will look at how was our portfolio performing before we launched for some period of time. And it's not necessarily very specific. A lot of times it's very arbitrary. People will say, you know, what was our growth trajectory, the percentage change in our volume for the 3 months leading up to the launch? And then they'll compare that to the same metric for the 3 months after the launch. So it's arbitrary. It looks at the entire market and it ignores other things that are happening in the marketplace, like your pricing may have changed during that time. Your distribution may have grown or shrank. The weather may have been really good or bad. If you're comparing the 3 months prior to the launch and the 3 months after the launch, then we have a seasonality issue, and beer is a very seasonal product, as are many other types of alcohol and other consumer goods. What did your competitors do during this period? And I actually have some clients who by coincidence launched a new product right at the beginning of the COVID-19 outbreak. And so they're comparing a time when there was no global pandemic to a time when there was a global pandemic. And it's not exactly apples to apples. And there's plenty of other things that could be going on that could affect this. So I don't recommend using this typical approach to new product incrementality and cannibalization estimation because it suffers from aggregation bias and ignores a lot of things that could be going on in the marketplace that are really important and that drive your overall performance. Okay, what should we do instead? If you have a little bit of data, and in general you do have more data than you think, and if you have some basic statistical software, and I mean even just Microsoft Excel can actually do what we're what I'm going to show you today, then you should be able to use a multidimensional approach that instead of just comparing the entire market at two points in time, you should be able to compare performance in every account where your products are sold, including your new product, at all times versus the performance of all of your products in every account in which they're sold at every other point in time. So we're moving from, you know, in terms of just the amount of data that we're looking at, we could be moving from two data points to dozens of millions of data points, depending on where all your products are sold. I've done analyses like this that had over 5 billion data points to account for. And when you have more data, you get more precise estimates. Okay, what data is going to be required to actually do this? Because I'm recommending that you use data that's actually at the account level, meaning either the retail account or wherever your product is being sold. That can be your tap room. It can be your brew pub. It can be, we can look at outlets or accounts as distributors. That works also. Whatever the lowest level of detail is where you're concerned about someone making a choice to either buy more or less of your product. Okay, you're going to need some way to identify those things, places where your product is sold. A period identifier is also necessary. It can be as low as a week ending date. I really like using weekly periods for an estimation like this because in terms of beer sales, a lot of beer accounts tend to buy on a weekly basis. Some of them buy a little more or a little less frequently than that, but it's a very common periodicity for beer sales. And I recommend using at least 3 years. Just in my experience, less than that tends to be a little less than precise and in terms of having enough data. And more than 3 years, you start to tack on 4 and 5 years, the data becomes less and less relevant because it's too long ago. So there's a happy medium there at about 3 years. You need to have your portfolio volume. And when I say portfolio here, we can actually use sort of whatever you want. Your beer portfolio, if you are, say you're a brand manager, if you work at one of the big shiny breweries that sells millions of barrels, then they have multiple brands. And so you might be looking at your portfolio as a brand family, like say the Miller Lite brand family or the Samuel Adams brand family. If that's your portfolio, that works perfectly fine. So you want to use the, for in econometrics language, we say the dependent variable in the regression equation that we're going to run, which actually just means the thing that we're trying to figure out how it's being affected. So that's your portfolio volume. That can be a brand, meaning just one specific brand within your brand portfolio, or it can be a brand family, or it can be your brewery's entire portfolio, or if you were estimating new product incrementality as, say, a distributor or retailer, then that can actually be all of the brands you carry from all of the breweries that you carry, okay? And then next, we want to include a price term. Price isn't actually the variable of interest here. We're not trying in this particular case to figure out what effect changes in your pricing have had on your portfolio. But since that's going to be information that generally you're going to have, and we know that price dramatically impacts the sales of more or less any product, we should include it, because if we don't have it, we're going to have imprecise estimates of our new product's incrementality. Because it could be the case that the price is changing, like I said before, it could be the case the price is changing at the same time as your new product's launch is going on, and we want to be able to account for that. Now, the thing that we're really interested in here is the new product's volume divided by the portfolio volume. And again, portfolio just meaning whatever bucket of sales volume you are now having this new product included in. So this ratio, the new product's volume over your portfolio volume, is an important variable, and that's the variable that we're actually really interested in here. We're trying to figure out how much changes in this ratio impact your overall product sales, okay? Lastly, additional controls can and generally should be used depending on whether or not you have that data available. The easiest thing to include is seasonality, because it can be entered very, very simply. You can have a variable in there for, does this week take place in the month of January or not? 0 or 1, and that's all. Does this week that we're looking at take place in the month of February? That sort of thing. That's a really simple way to control for seasonality. Another thing you can do, depending on availability of data, is you can get information on the weather that was present during when you're observing. That information is available from government sources, depending on where the geography that you want to look at. And I can help you find that sort of information if that's something that you're trying to include. I found that weather does impact beer sales in a way that is different from how just seasonality impacts beer sales. So including it, temperature information and precipitation information is actually pretty important. However, that said, if you can't do it, if the data isn't available for whatever reason, it is okay to exclude it, because you're going to have enough variation. If you're doing this right, you're going to have many thousands of observations, if not millions of observations of data to look at. So you will have enough sample size to make your estimates of new product incrementality precise enough, regardless of whether you include weather. But it's a nice control to have. Now, another thing that you're going to need is some statistical software. And like I said before, you can use Microsoft Excel for this because it does have regression capability. If the following conditions are met, if you have few enough controls, and I think the latest version of Excel can take up to 16 what are called in regression speak independent variables or things that we're using to control for what's happening to your volume. If you have more than 16, you're going to need some different software. And it's about 16. It's in the teens. I'm not 100% sure on that because, I personally don't typically use Excel. Additionally, if you have more than a million rows of data, Excel is not really going to cut it because Excel doesn't go much over a million rows. So, but, you know, for a lot of relatively small suppliers out there, if you're looking at weekly sales in every account that you're in, you might not be over a million rows, and that's okay. And then lastly, the other caveat for use of Excel that I didn't put on here because I had forgotten about it until just now is that if you're doing Excel on the local, meaning on your computer version for a Mac computer, those don't have regression capability. I don't know why. They took it out a couple of years ago. The Windows version still has regression capability. But if you don't have Windows Excel, or if you have more than a million rows, or if you have too many control variables, that's not a problem. All you need to do is use some different statistical software, and there are a bunch of options out there. You can use SAS, you can use R, you can use MATLAB, you can use Stata, SPSS. There's a bunch of different options. I have feelings about which ones are better or worse, but there's lots of options out there, and you can get your hands on them. Okay. All right, moving on. So the next thing is we're going to run this regression equation. We're estimating the log of portfolio volume on the ratio between the volume of your new product sales and the portfolio volume, then the log of your portfolio price, and then whatever controls you have. And the variable of interest here, the thing that we're really keen to understand, is this beta one, the coefficient on the ratio of the new product's volume to the volume of your existing portfolio. Now, I put a note down here just to say that this regression equation, it doesn't have an intercept term, because I figured there may be some people in the audience today wondering, oh, this regression doesn't have an intercept term. If you're sophisticated enough to know that it doesn't have an intercept term, you're probably already also sophisticated enough to know why. Is because I'm using cross-sectional fixed effects for this model. The short version of what that means is that we are going to remove the variation across different accounts that we're looking at and only look within accounts at variation, because there's two big reasons for that. They are that accounts are generally of different sizes, so comparing them directly doesn't typically work because they're such different sizes. But additionally, we're really only looking to understand what happens in an account when you change the proportion of new product volume to your portfolio volume. And if you do that right, you get this coefficient here, beta one, which is approximately equal to the new product's rate of incrementality, or one minus the rate of cannibalization, if you or your CEO like to talk about it in terms of cannibalization instead of incrementality. The reason I like to talk about incrementality is that it's the more positive spin. They're both, you know, really ultimately, whether we say incrementality or cannibalization, we're talking about how much a product that you launched hurt your other products. But incrementality is, again, the brighter side of it. You may have questions on how to actually estimate this equation. Again, the way to do it is with the data that I showed before. It's your own sales data. You know how much volume you sold in each account, whether you're self-distributing or if you have a distributor that you're working with. You can generally get from either the distributor or your data supplier, you can get the volume of product that you're selling in each individual account. And you can get it by week. You can put it into this regression equation and get estimates of the new product incrementality. If you have questions on how to acquire or clean or use that data, I'm available. You know, it's at EconBeer on Twitter. Okay, let's move on. Oh, here we go. Okay, so what do you actually do with these new product incrementality estimates? So what you're going to want to do, for one thing, after you've launched a product, you want to be able to understand what that product did for you. So this made up product here that we just for pretend launched in 2009, I called it Way Down South Lager. If you have a beer out there called Way Down South Lager, I'm sorry, I totally made these up or thought I did, but there may be a product out there called that. And I said, okay, this launch had 19% incrementality, meaning that a little more than 80% of the volume of this product that we sold starting in April of 2009 was cannibalized from our other volume, or 19% of it was just new demand that we got simply because we launched this new product. Okay. And that tells us a lot just by itself. Okay. It tells us how this launch went. It tells us, you know, whether or not our distributor and retailer partners have actually benefited much from the launch. So we can actually tell them just with that information how beneficial this product has been to our portfolio and by extension their business. Additionally, after we estimate multiple incrementality estimates for several products, and I've got a bunch of just made up beers here, but the important part is if we're getting incrementality estimates here ranging from like high single digits up to, you know, high 30% here, I've got one that says 37% incremental volume. Now we have an understanding of what kind of incrementality we can expect. So if we're working with our distributor and retailer partners and they want to know, okay, you haven't launched this new product that you want me to carry yet, how much is it going to add to my business? Then you should be able to tell them, we don't know yet because we haven't launched it, but similar products that we've launched in the past have had rates of incrementality in the 20s and 30s. So you can expect that it's going to have between 20 and 30, maybe up to 40% of its volume is going to be incremental. And this is just based on made up numbers. So please don't report just those numbers. The idea here is to make it based on your launches that you've estimated new product incrementality on. Okay. And if you're considering a new product internally, right, say you are the innovations committee for a large brewer and you have one of your brand managers comes to you and says, I've got this great new package of a brand that we have, or I've got this great new liquid, I want to turn it into our next big flagship beer. Their business case should include how much it's going to sell first off, and how you're going to do that, what kind of distribution it's going to get. And another thing that business case should have is it should include an estimate of how much of its volume is going to be cannibalized from your existing products and how much of its volume is going to be incremental to your portfolio sales. Now, if these are the rates of incrementality that you've had in the past, and your brewer, you know, if you're just the CEO of a small brewery and your brewer comes to you and says, hey, I've got this great new product. I think it's going to have really low cannibalization. I think it's going to have like 1-2% cannibalization. If you're, you know, the innovations committee at a larger brewery and your brand manager comes to you and says, I've got this great new package. It's going to only cannibalize 2% of volume and it's going to have 98% incremental volume. There's reason to be skeptical because you have this history that you've been gathering over time, all the launches that you've made. You should be able to say 98% incremental volume doesn't really make sense given that we've never had higher than 37% incremental volume. I think that we should be a little bit reluctant to put that new product out if the business case is saying that we're going to have sky high incrementality, because that throws into question whether or not all of the numbers in that business case are going to be reflective of reality. Okay. Now, moving on here. Break-even incrementality is another important idea that you can employ without having to estimate the incrementality of a new product. Okay. So you have an idea for a new beer or a new package of an existing beer or what have you. Like I said earlier, a product can be more or less profitable. Say you're putting the same beer in a package that is going to be less profitable, but you think that it hits a niche, it's a consumer occasion that our existing packaging for this beer just doesn't hit. That is actually totally reasonable. If, say, you've only ever sold the beer on draft and the new thing that you're launching is six-pack aluminum cans, yeah, that has a lot of opportunity to have some incremental new occasions for your drinkers to have that beer where they otherwise couldn't have had it. If instead, though, you have like a slew of different sizes of can packages and you're just launching a 3-pack of 11-ounce cans, that doesn't actually have a lot of potential to be extraordinarily incremental because you already have a bunch of other things that are similar. But importantly, also, there are no 3-pack 11-ounce cans that I'm aware of. So creating such a product would probably be really expensive and it wouldn't be tremendously profitable. So if you're comparing the margin that you're making on the new product, whatever it is, be it a new package of an existing beer or a new beer completely, if you compare the margin of that new product that you are considering launching to the margins of your products that it's likely to cannibalize. So if it's a 3-pack 11-ounce can of beer that you're considering putting out, which I know it's ridiculous, I'm just using it as an example, and you know, you make X amount of money on it, you want to divide that number by the likely cannibalized products. And, you know, for a 3-pack 11-ounce can, I think that would compare pretty reasonably to a 4-pack 12-ounce can, which many of you listening today sell 4-pack 12-ounce cans. So we compare those two margins, and the rate of incrementality that you need to make that innovation profitable is the rate of incrementality has to be at least higher than this ratio. So if the new product is only 40% as profitable, as in the margin is like 60% less than the cannibalized products, you can actually make more profits, more margin on your overall portfolio if you sell it, but it has to be at least 40% incremental. It can be, you know, 40, 45, 50% incremental, and you can still make more money as long as this ratio is satisfied. But if the margin is too low, meaning, you know, the new product is much, much less profitable than the products that it's going to be cannibalizing, then you definitely shouldn't launch that product if the rate of incrementality that you're going to get is going to be too low. And again, how can you tell if the rate of incrementality that you're going to get is too low? You have these business cases. We can say, oh, okay, when we launched Punch Drunk IPA 3-pack 11-ounce cans back in 2010, we achieved very little incrementality. I think this time when we launch this other 3-pack 11-ounce, it's not going to be very incremental either. And we're not going to achieve the level of incrementality that we need to make money. Okay. So to sum up here, importantly, when you launch new products, they often cannibalize products that you already have, and that's going to impact your profits. It isn't necessarily going to decrease your profits if the new product is sufficiently profitable and or sufficiently incremental in terms of the sales that it's going to hit. It's not a good idea to use a simple pre-post approach to analyzing your new product innovations in terms of how much incremental sales they delivered. I have seen people use that approach and miraculously show that somehow the new product delivered twice as much incremental volume as even the new product sold, which doesn't make theoretical sense. And the reason that it happened in this particular case was that right when that happened, there was a huge increase in the portfolio's distribution. They opened up a new market and they attributed all of that new distribution volume to the new product's launch, which shouldn't have happened. It's a mistake. All right. Instead, you should be using a multidimensional approach to estimating your new product's incrementality. That's going to take you from comparing just your overall market at two different points in time to every place where someone can make a decision to either buy more or less or the same amount of your beer. And it's going to allow you to compare each one of those to every other time and place a person can choose to buy more or less or the same amount of your beer. So you have a lot more information that you're working with, and it's going to be a lot more precise estimates. Another thing here is people get daunted by having to do a lot of analytical work for a variety of reasons, one of which is that people worry that the data isn't available. But this data that you need to accomplish this analysis is data that you actually have in-house. You know how much volume you sold in each individual account, and you know when you sold it, you know which packages, which brands you sold, and you can use that information, you know, essentially for free. It's data that you already have. I know you're paying to have resources like computers and data suppliers and whatnot, but that's data that you probably are already in control of. You don't need to hire any of the syndicated data suppliers to get information on how much volume you sold and for how much money and where. Okay. Now, assuming you're able to do all of this incrementality estimates for one, two, three new product launches, you start to develop a history of new product launches and how much incremental volume they were able to deliver for you. And so now you should be able to gain an understanding of what to expect. When you launch a new product, it's probably going to have incrementality in the neighborhood of what your previous new product launches have had. And the more similar the launches, the more similar the incrementality estimates are likely to be. So we can pressure test business cases in a couple of ways. One, if you're considering a new product that requires for it to meet its volume targets and to meet your overall portfolio sales targets, if the incrementality needs to be, you know, well above the incrementality rates that you've been getting in the past, it's probably not a great idea because it's not realistic. And, or if the margin on the new product is a lot smaller than the margins on the products that it's going to cannibalize, and specifically the threshold is you have to have the new product be at least as incremental as the ratio of its margin to the existing products. Okay. If the margin on the new product is only, you know, 20% of the margin on the existing products that it's going to cannibalize, then it has to be at least 20% incremental. If it isn't at least 20% incremental to your volume, it's not going to make you money. It's going to lose money overall. You're going to be down profits for every unit you sell. So it's not a good idea to sell a product that doesn't meet that criterion. Okay, so we haven't seen any questions coming up in the stream here, but we can open it up to questions now if people have them. All right. I am just going to look for a little bit here to see if we get any questions. Okay, it's totally fine. Not seeing any questions right now. I really appreciate everyone who joined us and everybody who came on to watch this in the recording. I want to thank Andrew for setting this up for us today over at Craft Beer Professionals. And please, if anybody has any questions, you can send them to me. You can send them to Andrew. I'm at EconBeer on Twitter. You can go to seventhpointanalytic.com for all of your strategic and analytic consulting needs. All right. Thanks a lot. Have a great day.